lecture is Democracy from the Margins. Can I now request the speaker for this lecture, Kanchan Chandra, Professor, New York University, to please come on stage. And may I request the chairperson to now take over the proceedings.
If everybody could please settle down, thank you. I'd like to welcome you to this Silver Jubilee lecture. Eighth in the series since yesterday, Professor Kanchan Chandra from New York University. Doesn't really require much of an introduction, but her work is mainly on questions of ethnicity, democracy, violence, patronage, clientelism, and party politics in South Asia. And the subject of her lecture is one of great interest, I dare say, not only for Bihar and Jharkhand, but the whole of India, Democracy from the Margins.
So I'm really delighted to be here. And before I start, I want to thank Dr. Gupta, Shaiva Gupta, Dr. Prabhat Ghosh, and Adri, all of the coordinating staff, of all of the team at Adri, for putting together really such a spectacular conference. I'm very delighted to be here, delighted to see everyone. So thank you for that. I am going to talk about democracy from the margins. It's not specifically about Bihar, but of course, I will speak a little bit about Bihar, and it is an obvious context in which Bihar politics can be placed. And of course, again, I'm not going to speak specifically about the UP elections, but given this topic, that is certainly part of the backdrop in this argument as well. And so, democracy from the margins, the subject of the talk is exactly as it sounds. It is about evaluating democracy in India from the perspective of how it has performed or how it has treated marginal groups or subaltern groups. I use the term interchangeably. And so by subalternity or marginality, I mean simply a condition based on exclusion from power and resources. So it's not a matter of numbers in the sense that you have numerical minorities who are a small percentage of the population. Subalternity is just, it's a condition of subordination. And I think it was Spivak who explained the concept. It really refers to a predicament, not an identity. And so the question of who is a subaltern group is an obviously fluid one. It can change. There are many groups that can be marginal at any point of time. And in the talk today, because I'm focusing really on the national level politics, the national parliament, I'm going to use these four categories, scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, Muslim and backward caste, Dalit, Adivasi, Muslim and backward caste, as a snapshot. But these are not the categories that are relevant in many regional and local contexts. And these categories are also in the process of being transformed. So please feel free to raise questions about that fluidity if you would like. So why look at democracy from the margins? And yeah, there are a couple of reasons. You know, one thing I want to highlight is by focusing on subaltern groups, I don't want to imply that speaking about Dalit politics or Adivasi politics is a matter for Dalits or Adivasis or backward castes alone. The point of departure for this talk is that looking at democracy from the margins tells you something about the health of democracy writ large, because a democracy or the performance of a democracy is only as good as its worst off group. And then in a context where the boundaries between majorities and minorities are fluid, any majority in the present can be part of a minority tomorrow. And so a democracy that is responsive to subaltern groups is a democracy that is more just overall. And so that's the perspective I start from. So when it comes to looking at the performance of democracy in India, the main success story is on political inclusion. If you look at other indicators by which the performance of a democracy might be evaluated, there the story is not usually one of success. It could be a story of slow progress. So for instance, when it comes to poverty, there are multiple ways of thinking about poverty, there are multiple indicators of poverty. And you know, if you measure poverty by many indicators, you do see a decline over time. The question is the decline fast enough? What is the counterfactual? So in some cases, you see, say, at best, slow progress. In other cases, you see failure. So when it comes to creating jobs, for instance, in the new economy, India, as you all know, is distinguished by a pattern of jobless growth. When it comes to indicators of, say, health, or nutrition, or hunger, when it comes to health, Indrez and Sen have written about this, India performs really at the, you know, sometimes worse than sub-Saharan Africa. When it comes to violence, India is one of the most violent democracies in the world. And so there are many aspects when we measure the performance of democracy by which the Indian democratic system does not perform that well. Regardless, you know, you could use a range of comparison sets. You could compare it to its neighbors in South Asia. You could compare it to China, which is the other country that is transforming economically on this scale. You could compare it to the US or the UK or other established democracies. But no matter which comparison set you place it in, there are many of these other dimensions on which the performance of Indian democracy, especially when it comes to subaltern groups, is nothing to write home about. But when it comes to political inclusion, the conventional story is that democracy in India has become deeply inclusive over time, and the terms you see here about this are the subalternization or the plebeianization of democracy in India. And this, regardless of how else India performs, is generally seen as a success story. I'm going to focus for the rest of the talk on political exclusion as a way to evaluate the performance of democracy for subaltern groups. And why, I just want to highlight why I think political inclusion is important. It's not because descriptive representation is the only legitimate form of representation. At least that is not my argument. There are sort of many ways in which people outside your identity category can represent you effectively, and many ways in which people who belong to your identity category may not be effective representatives. I also do not think that political inclusion, the case for political inclusion, is that it is a means to an end when it comes to programmatic reform in favor of disadvantaged groups. We know that in many cases, when subaltern politicians or political parties come to power, they may or may not adopt policies that writ large that favor a subaltern group. But there are at least a couple of reasons to make the case for political inclusion. One is because descriptive representation sends a signal of empowerment and belonging. It is a good in itself. It establishes self-esteem and a form of belonging. And the second is, in a context where the survival and the everyday rights of citizens depends not just on long-term programmatic reform, but on everyday interactions with the state. You know, you have to file an FIR, you need a caste certificate, you need your ration card, even in the days of a sort of cashless economy, or, you know, if you have to open a bank account or you need an Aadhaar card, you still have to provide a set of documents in order to get more documents. And so there is a way in which in everyday interactions with the state, having people from your category who belong to the state can at a minimum produce a more humane interaction with the state. And so it is these very minimal ways in which I want to make a case for why political inclusion is important on its own grounds, regardless of what it could be a means to. And then this is the takeaway point of the talk. This really is the outline of the rest of my remarks. The broad point I want to make, it's really a pessimistic story, and I'm sorry to follow Vinita, it was another pessimistic presentation. But I want to highlight is the big success story on political inclusion in India is not such a big success story after all. The story of subaltern entry into legislatures has really been overhyped. There has been some entry, but I want to show you some data that suggests there really has not been as much subalternization in democracy in India as we thought. And you know, the main arguments about subalternization have really been to do with the entry into legislature, the Vidhan Sabha or the Lok Sabha. I'm going to talk in my, you know, my talk really about the Lok Sabha. But if we, you know, even if we accept the story of subalternization, legislatures represent only the outer circle of power. And if we start looking at the inner circles, at the cabinet, or at chief ministers, or at political dynasties, here you really see very limited, in fact, you know, I don't see indicators of subalternization or a trend towards subalternization. Sometimes it's quite the opposite. It is a trend towards entrenchment of dominance. And why? So this, I'll come to this at the end of the talk. First, I just want to show you some data making these points. And why do you see, you know, sort of a limit to subalternization and sometimes counter trends? I want to argue that it is because of political parties. Most parties in parliament are still dominated by forward caste groups. Most subaltern legislators, so when we look at what is seen as the subalternization of democracy in India, and you see the sort of new legislators from new groups who enter parliament or the legislative assemblies, one point that gets missed is that most subaltern legislators belong to parties led by dominant groups. And so this limits both their ascent from the outer to the inner corridors of power, and it also shapes and limits their voice. So this is what I'll focus on. Maybe if there's some time at the end, I might return to the question, say, of the UP elections, but if there's not time, I'll stop here. So these are data that show you the subalternization of the Lok Sabha from 1951 to, it should be really 2014. And I say these are provisional figures, A, because, you know, anything after 2000 is our data that I've collected and coded and compiled myself. Data before 2000 is from other sources. And when it comes to, I think, particularly questions of ethnic identity, we can't really take statistics as an objective fact or as given. So there's some provisionality here just in making sure the categories match, and, you know, to address, to think about what these data mean when you think about the question of fluidity and self-identification. But for the rest of the talk, you just take these figures as provisional. So what you see here you just have two categories, Hindu forward castes, and that is the blue line, and the subaltern groups, and that is just a broad category that includes everybody, Dalit, Adivasi, backward caste, Muslim, Christian, other categories. And what you see here is, at least from 1984 onwards, there is a trend towards an increasing representation for subaltern groups and a decreasing representation for Hindu upper castes. And so this seems to support a subalternization story. But already from the chart, you see that from 2009 onwards, you see really a tapering off of the trend. There isn't any, you see sort of a status quo between the 2009 and 2014. Parliaments. But now I want to break it down and show you, if we break down the category of subaltern groups, really this point about subalternization is really just a point about backward caste entry. When it comes to Dalits or Adivasis, there has been no change. When it comes to Muslims, there has actually been a decline. And if we broaden the notion of subalternity to think about other groups, for instance, women, there also, you know, it would be hard to argue that there is, I mean, there's sort of a little bit of an increase, but hard to argue that you see this kind of subalternization of the Lok Sabha. So this is just breaking it down by the type of group or the type of category represented. And really the takeaway point is the gray line is are the Hindu upper castes, and the red line are the backward castes. And there you see with the backward castes, you actually see an increase over time. But when it comes to the other groups, it's not a story of subalternization. You know, so the first thing often in speaking about the subalternization of democracy in India, by not focusing at least on these disaggregated categories, you can often lose sight of the fact that even if there is some broad trend, there are categories within this broad trend that are not better off over time when it comes to inclusion. But then there's a second point. If you compare, there is often this point made that India as a democracy is so much more inclusive than other established democracies. Wendy and I were talking yesterday about the US. The US, for instance, has three, I mean, it had a black president, but it has three black senators. And if you actually look at the US Senate website, it can tell you over hundreds of years, it can list all the non-white members it has had, and all of the names fit on one page. You know, so at that level, it seems it's a very low level of inclusion, nothing comparable to what we have in India. But if you look at the degree of overrepresentation compared to the percentage in the population, India actually is not doing that well when it comes to inclusion. So this is just, I just sort of put this on the slide. It looks at the overrepresentation of dominant groups in established democracies. And the three countries I look at there are India, the US, and the UK. So, you know, to look at overrepresentation, you have to know what the proportion of the group is in the population. And because when it comes to racial and ethnic identities, there is a question of, you know, the self-identification. In most cases, certainly the US and the UK, but particularly the US, the census now allows you to check more than one category. There's been an evolution in census categories over time. So please do take the baseline figures with a pinch of salt. When it comes to upper castes in India, there's no established figure. The figure that I use there is based on, it's taken it from the Sachar Commission report, and it's based on the National Sample Survey data from 2004-2005. But the point here is you could, you know, the figures could change by say 10% and the broad point would still be the same. So if you take those data and say upper castes are an estimated 22% of the population, they are about 43% of the current Lok Sabha. And so there is an overrepresentation by a factor of two. You have twice as many upper caste MPs as you have sort of the percentage of upper caste in the population. When it comes to the US, 69% of the electorate is classified as white. 76% of the House of Representatives is white, and 91% of the Senate is classified as white. So here, I mean, at one level, if you're just looking at numbers, you'd say, well, 91% of the Senate is white. But if you look at it in relation to the population, whites are overrepresented in the US Congress by a factor of 1.1 in the House of Representatives, sorry, I'm missing that, and a factor of 1.3 in the Senate. In the UK, these are data from the House of Commons, 87% of the population is white, 94% of MPs are classified as white. And so there's overrepresentation by a factor of 1.08. And so you still see, when you take this into account, there has been a decline in upper caste, or sort of dominant groups in Parliament over time, but it's not a large decline, and it certainly doesn't place India at the top of a sort of a list of political inclusion when we compare it to other established democracies in the world. And then finally, this is, if you look at the inner corridors of power, the position of prime minister, chief minister, cabinet, and dynastic politics. So 14 out of 17 prime ministers in India have been from the upper caste, the only two backward caste prime ministers, Devi Gowda, and of course now Narendra Modi. And at the end of the talk, I want to say something about what Modi's prime ministership implies for inclusion. And so the backward caste prime ministers have held position for 4 years so far, but the overwhelming time the position of prime minister has been held by upper castes. When it comes to chief ministers, currently, I just, you know, this is current as of today, 15 of the 29 current chief ministers are from the Hindu Forward caste, and this is actually an increase from the last year of the Congress government. About 43% of the cabinet, this is the cabinet in 2014, it doesn't accommodate the subsequent reshuffles, came from the Forward caste. And also, if you look at the cabinet from 1951 to the present, there is no trend towards decline. When you look at dynastic politics, this comes from some of my work published last year. Only 43% of the parliament is from Hindu upper castes. But when it comes to dynastic MPs, 54% of dynastic MPs, the majority of dynastic MPs are upper caste MPs, and this has actually increased. There has been a secular increase from 2004, 2009, and 2014. And so I think what you see here, the story here is that there is the degree of subalternization of democracy in India, the degree of inclusion is limited. And there isn't, you know, the big period of inclusion was in the 90s and the early 2000s, but there does now seem to be a leveling off. So even in that limited degree, I don't see how it would, you know, one could make an argument for a deep or major increase. And then once you move from the outer circles to the inner circles of power, there you're really seeing a form of entrenchment or sometimes an increase in the opposite direction. I'm going to skip that. And so now the question is, why do we actually see this trend? And here I think the important thing to look at is not the legislature, but to look at the degree of inclusion we have within political parties. So the majority of seats in parliament belong to parties dominated by Forward castes. And here, you know, one of the interesting things, and this, I mean, I focus again on parliament, but many of the regional parties have a seat in parliament, and so this would tell you something about the regional parties as well. What's interesting is there is almost very few political parties in India at the national level, and certainly no major party that is exclusively monopolized by a single group. Now, most parties have a fairly diverse set of legislators, but, and this is the important thing, almost all parties also are dominated. They always have a core group that dominates the sort of plurality or the majority of their MPs. So they have a diverse set of legislators, but there is a core group, and then there are a number of smaller or satellite groups. So the majority of parties in parliament, accounting for 456 seats out of 543 seats, you have parties that are dominated by Forward caste. This includes the BJP and the Congress, where the plurality of MPs is still Forward caste, and then a number of other smaller regional parties as well. And most Dalit or Adivasi or backward caste legislators, 70% of backward caste MPs, 83% of Dalit MPs, 92% of scheduled tribe MPs, 50% of Muslim MPs enter parliament through upper caste dominated parties. What this means is, so when it comes to dynastic politics, for example, or when it comes to cabinet berths, or when it comes to, say, chief ministerial appointments, many of those decisions are made based on who dominates or who has clout in the factional structure within political parties. And groups that end up being a minority within their political parties also end up having their representation or having their voice or having their power diluted when it comes to representative institutions. And so this is a case where political parties are actually siphoning off the way in which the path which subaltern legislators or subaltern aspiring politicians take to power makes a big difference. So essentially you have a process by which political parties are refracting the kind of power that subaltern legislators may have enjoyed. And here, so the question is, you know, where is the path then to meaningful inclusion? It lies, I want to suggest here, through the subalternization of political parties, not just legislatures. And so the place to look at would be within political parties and not across them, to look at the organization, the patterns of organization within political parties and not just intra-party competition. And here, you know, when it comes to minority groups, I want to address the question of ethnic parties or identity-based parties, parties that are dominated by particular ethnic groups. There is a tendency both in the literature on ethnic identity politics, which is part of what I work on, and also in the everyday discourse among sort of people who think about politics in India, that identity-based parties, communal parties are somehow divisive or destabilizing. You should have parties that speak for the people in general. But when it comes to minority groups, identity-based parties that are parties which are, say, dominated by minority or subaltern groups, I want to suggest can actually be democratizing, not destabilizing. It's not a blanket argument for all kinds of identity-based parties, but for subaltern parties, having parties dominated by their own group can make a difference to their ascent to actually meaningful patterns of inclusion here. And so here, in fact, the recent elections in UP, the fact that the BSP was actually wiped out, I mean 19 seats in a state where it once had a majority, that is something I want to raise which is worth considering, not for the case of the BSP in itself, but for what it means for political inclusion. You have a situation in India where there is no major national level political party or even a major regional party that is dominated by Dalits, now with the BSP's loss, but also by Adivasis, or also by Muslims. And you know, the fact that the Indian party system for a long time has not had major sort of the ethnic parties that represent subaltern groups have not taken up a major share of the national vote is, I think, from many perspectives seen as a positive thing. And what I want to highlight is that that actually may be a negative thing when you think about political inclusion and voice for subaltern groups. And one example to raise here is if you think about the public discourse that followed Rohit Vemula's suicide. What's interesting is the majority of Dalit legislators now belong to the BJP, so not to the Congress and certainly not to the BSP. And the fact that they were speaking from within the BSP also meant, sorry, within the BJP, also meant that their voice was not the voice which defined the position of the party. And so here, if you think about, you know, sort of taking a step back to identity politics within Indian states broadly, where you see identity-based political parties that ended up occupying a major space in the political mainstream, this really started happening first in the South with social reform movements in Kerala, the non-Brahmin movement in Tamil Nadu. And in those states, you ended up with regional political parties, ruling parties that saw subaltern groups occupy a dominant position. And this is not necessarily an unqualified good. I mean, what happened is also you had one layer of subaltern groups occupy a dominant position, ruling position, and very often lock out groups lower in the social hierarchy from power. So it's not as if that's actually my own warning for a limited amount. I'll stop in a few minutes. So it's not the case that identity-based parties are necessarily a solution to all forms. I mean, they can create new forms of subalternity. But what happened in that case is a deeper level of political inclusion than what you see now in the North. The interesting case here now with the North is that Bihar is maybe the only state, I'm going through the examples, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, West Bengal. Bihar is, I think, quite exceptional in the sense that you have a sort of entrenched parties that actually sort of are dominated by subaltern groups. That, you know, it's sort of a more typical factor in the South, but more unusual for the North now. And I think with the UP election, you know, when it comes to, I have a slide on subaltern legislators, there's just enough time to address this. When it comes to regional legislatures, I focus really, you know, on the parliament. And this comes from, and sort of, you know, so many people here whose work is relevant from work by Sanjay Kumar and Christoph Jaffrelot. When you look at subaltern representation in regional legislatures, there is a decrease in upper caste MLAs between the 1950s and the present for most states for which we have data, but the decrease is very slight in several cases. And in those cases, we actually still don't know enough about the parties through which these subaltern legislators enter. And there is in some of, UP is one of the states in which there was the greatest decline, or sort of the greatest kind of UP-Bihar subalternization between the 1950s and the present. And in UP, what you see now is a reversal, sort of a return for the last election. You see a rise in the percentage of upper caste legislators. And so I think this is a case where either the trend wasn't that deep to start with, or the trend, to the extent that you can call it that, is being reversed now in some cases. The final point, and I want to speak, just say one thing on Modi and what that represents when it comes to political inclusion. So of course, I said a backward caste prime minister has occupied the chair only for 4 years, Modi for 3 years and Devi Gowda for 1 year. But Modi is a very powerful prime minister and a very, sort of maybe the most powerful leader the BJP has ever had. And of course, he is from the backward caste. And so this is the last slide, this is a bit of a speculative point. But you know, what does Modi's ascent mean for political inclusion? Here, what's interesting about Modi is you have a backward caste prime minister who is very, very forthright. He claims his identity. And I, you know, if you think about the comparison between Modi and Obama, Modi is far more forthright about his caste identity and mentions it more often than Obama has ever really been about race. But the interesting thing about Modi is he claims his caste identity without being defined by it. And so he is not just or not been primarily a backward caste prime minister. And caste has not been the defining factor in many of his policies, whether they are questions of personnel appointments, the chief minister he's chosen, or the set of reform policies that he has introduced. And I think what this might suggest, it's a different mode of inclusion. And it makes me think of Sri Lanka, where you actually had, at the time that Sri Lanka was independent, a very strong sort of an entrenchment of caste politics. But over time, through really sort of, you know, political party competition, but also through the politics of polarization, a very conspicuous diminishing of caste as a relevant identity in national level politics, it became very much a local level factor. And as we think about political inclusion, I think some of what is happening both with the BJP, but with Modi as a figure in charge of the BJP, may also suggest a redefinition of the notion of inclusion. You know, because if you think about the fluidity inherent in ethnic identities, one way to bring about political inclusion or to prevent it is to actually prevent people from occupying positions. But another is to redefine the identities on the basis of which inclusion is measured and sort of redefine the yardsticks altogether. And I think some of what is happening with Modi as Prime Minister may be that kind of redefinition of identity. Let me stop here.
Really enjoyed that. But is it okay to include Muslims as a subaltern group without qualification? And does it distort any of your figures?
Is it valid to include Muslims as a subaltern group? And
do they distort the figures?
Is it valid to include Muslims as a subaltern group?
What are the qualifications? I think there's what I've done is introduce categories without contextualization. So I haven't said anything about the meaning or the place or the socioeconomic condition of any of the categories. But when you say without qualification, what do you mean?
Well, not all Muslims are subaltern by a range of criteria to do with their power, their education,
the positions they occupy, and so on.
I think that's actually a point. I mean, I think you're right. I sort of used a shorthand, and not that point would apply to any of these groups. So for instance, you have better off groups among the backward castes, you have better off groups among Dalits, you have worse off groups among the Hindu upper castes. So I don't think that point applies just to Muslims. It would apply to any kind of identity-based template. I do want to highlight, though, that if you think about the level of underrepresentation, it is greatest for Muslims compared to the other categories. You have now 4%, 22 Muslims in the current Lok Sabha, which is really very low and quite low for a long time. So in that sense, I think it's quite reasonable. I don't think the figures are distorted.
Go ahead.
You said that Jawaharlal Nehru was a forward caste prime minister and Narendra Modi is a backward caste prime minister. Do you mean to say that Narendra Modi has contributed to subverting of Indian democracy more than what Nehru did?
So I want to highlight that when I made the case for inclusion, I quite emphatically said I don't think descriptive representation necessarily means that the actions you take are actions that are going to favor your particular group. So I did say that in many cases you have people outside your category who might make sort of institute far-reaching reforms, and people who are within your category who may not. So I'm not taking a position on who achieved more on what dimension, Modi or Nehru. But I'm making a case for political inclusion on its own grounds, regardless of what policy objectives it achieves. And on those grounds, yes, a backward caste prime minister has been in power for a far shorter length of time than upper caste prime minister.
And my second observation is that to understand subalternization of Indian democracy, it's important to understand it in terms of numbers or in terms of policies and ideology.
So, I think...
Do you have a connected question? Thanks so much. I thought that was a really brilliant presentation, and a depressing one, as you suggested. I'd like to suggest an alternative conclusion to the one that you presented. And that is that we go back to why the concept of subaltern, the subaltern, was used in India in the first place, and how it came to us through the work of Ranajit Guha in Elementary Aspects of a Peasant Insurgency, and through the kind of tradition following Gramsci of looking at the masses that were not that were not dominated, so the dominance without hegemony. And so I would like to suggest that actually the real democratization of Indian society may be that which is taking place outside of political parties and outside of the party structures, and that actually your presentation perhaps could be concluded in terms of us going back to the original ideas of subaltern studies, which were looking at dominance without hegemony in contemporary India as opposed to in the past, and that you use Ranajit Guha rather than Spivak as your theorization for the notion of a subaltern.
I just a very brief remark. Is Rajiv Gandhi considered upper caste or Parsi? That is a serious comment.
Yeah.
We had a Parsi prime minister who went on pretending not to be Parsi, who never considered Parsi, but still had a Parsi funeral. So, you know, we have to be very aware that we shouldn't consider Rajiv Gandhi to be Brahmin, no matter what they want.
If I recall the funeral of Indira Gandhi, he had a Jadeva war when he...
Yeah, and how is Manmohan Singh considered? He's a Dalit. He's a Sikh Dalit. Of course he's a Sikh Dalit.
He's Khatri.
He's a Jat.
Are you sure? And I
don't know. We've got different stories here.
First of all, let me appreciate your presentation. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm Dr. Vijayalakshmi, Secretary to the Government here, working with Bihar Government. My question is, where do you actually see women in the entire spectrum? Women. And, you know, there are differing views about introducing reservation for women in the Indian Parliament. So what are your views on it? If at all we introduce reservations, for women, then how do you actually see it? You know, the same story of, you know, forward caste men, the story which is like, you know, now relevant for men, is going to be repeated for women, like, you know, for forward caste women are going to grab the positions. What are your views on that?
Professor Young,
I've enjoyed listening to your presentation, which I really much appreciate. But I wonder if you can reduce the political constellation of India to identity politics only, or mainly. And I refer you to the recent, the outcome of the recent elections in UP, where, according to the information we received, two-thirds of the candidates of the MLAs have a criminal record, and a bit more than two-thirds of the delegates are corporatists, are millionaires. So I would invite you to back up what you have said, also by class indications, and not only caste or community or creed indications. Thank you.
Sure. I'll just go through the questions in order. You know, the question, I'll pass two questions. One is about the conceptualization of subaltern as sort of outside dominance, and the other is about the role of party structures. You see, I just responded, I think maybe to the latter part on the question of party structures. And maybe that it's addressed not the conceptual point, but the reason why I look at parties or at subaltern groups in relation to parties. You know, India is quite unique, I think, in this, what I think of as a paradox of weak political parties that matter tremendously. So political parties, you have in many cases, I mean, apart from the BJP and the CPI, CPM, and even there is a lot of organizational sort of weakness at the local or regional level. But most political parties are organizationally weak. You have a number of parties that are essentially nothing more than the label and the person who is in charge.
Yeah.
But parties are quite incredibly important. If you look at election surveys, the majority of voters will look at parties or parties and candidates. You don't have an individualistic system the way that you do in the Philippines, for instance, or Russia. You know? So one of the things I've always been trying to understand is why, when parties can be so organizationally hollow, do they matter so much? No? But in many cases, also, if you look at the Singur agitation, for example, or you look at movements that happen outside political parties, many of the most successful ones, or sooner or later, they end up or they make an impact through political parties. I think Singur is one example, and you can contrast that with many agitations, Polavaram, for instance, which was not taken up by a political party, or the Aam Aadmi Party, which again came out of a social movement, you know? So in this context, you know, and thinking about Jenkins' book on the SEZs, where there again, there's a very variable pattern of political party involvement, but it can be quite important in strengthening a movement. What I saw with the BSP in UP in the early 90s is, as a political party, getting involved in questions of land or in local disputes went a long way towards settling issues that are being settled in other areas now through a different kind of violence. You know, so it comes, I think, from an empirical observation of the importance of parties, despite the fact that they're weak. When it comes to dynastic politics, you know, if you compare India, say, with Pakistan or with the Philippines, you have families that are substitute for parties. They can actually, families jump or switch between political parties, and the voters follow suit. In India, it's different. In India, it's a conjunction of the dynasty with the party. When dynasties leave their parties, they end up not doing very well. There are very few dynastic candidates, for instance, who win as independents. And so I think that's part of where this is coming from. But I also want to highlight, you know, for this presentation, I focus really on a decontextualized set of categories, you know, without really unpacking the categories themselves. And one reason I do that is precisely because I sort of read so much about how inclusive democracy is, and that the inclusion is often used as a response for failures on other dimensions. And so with 30 minutes, I wanted to focus just quite specifically on that point. That said, and I'll come to your question on women in a moment, that said, I think there is a lot more to be gained by taking these thinly defined categories and actually unpacking them, looking at questions of class, as you know, as Jan raised, certainly looking at questions of class, other dimensions of subalternity, and also gender, and then looking at patterns of intersection, you know. Those things are easier to do or better done with contextual work, you know, with field work, you know, and so I didn't speak a lot about that here, but I think that certainly needs to be done. When it comes to women, now the interesting thing is, again, you know, there's sort of this celebration of democracy in India when it comes to representation, but of course, when it comes to the representation of women, India has one of the lowest levels, sort of does quite poorly when it comes to gender representation. When you look at women, for, again, not you can't say for all democracies, but for democracies for which there are data, in many countries, women end up being disproportionately dynastic. But in India, you have this paradox, you have a small number of women, I think it's now 12%, it was 12%, but with a much higher percentage of dynasticism than in other cases, you know, and so without the, what you also see is groups that have quotas end up using institutions as a way to get a foot in the door. Groups that do not have quotas, and that is true of women, that is true of Muslims, that is true, I mean, you tell me, you know, I don't think this quite qualifies as a subaltern group, but also young people. Groups that do not have quotas are often using family ties as their way to get their foot in the door. You know, so, I think I'll stop.
Ambassador Dilipsana and Ashutosh then. How much time
do we have?
2 minutes.
Well, thank you for your paper. I think that's some very interesting data on Indian inclusiveness. But when you make international comparisons, it might be useful to keep in mind that while caste in India is a fairly defined and well-studied issue, in the US and UK, the distinctions are much more subtle and based more on class. For example, to find a non-Ivy League president, you'll have to go back 3 decades in the US. David Cameron's cabinet was dominated by products of one school, Eton. So those issues of inclusion also need to be taken into account when we make comparisons between India and other countries. Thanks.
How much time do we have, sir?
30 seconds.
No, 30 seconds. I can talk to you later. All right.
Okay, last character.
This is Manish from Madri. You know, the rise of the Dalits and the OBCs in India, you know, that has taken place post-91, you know, that is also the period of economic reforms in India. So did you find any correlation between political inclusion and economic inclusion in your mind? Number one. Number two, you have given us the data of people, you know, coming from forward caste or backward caste, who directly entered the, who entered with the people represented in the legislatures. So any data on ticket distribution to different groups by different political parties? Or thank you.
So I think, I mean, I can take these questions together. You know, on the question about class in the US or the UK, I mean, of course, class manifests itself differently in India, in the US, and the UK. I think what I want to highlight is simply when it comes to class, you know, there's no reason, I think no justification for using only one dimension of identity when looking at subalternity. Of course you have to look at class. I think class, given the nebulousness, so with ethnic identity, one of the interesting things is there are visible markers, there are people who can recognize each other as being part of the same ethnic category, whereas this question of visibility and mutual recognizability is actually different when it comes to class. So I think when you look at patterns of subalternity in terms of class, at least in the beginning, it is actually better done through contextual work than through the numbers, because you could classify people as belonging to the same class if they went to the same school or had the same level of education, but you don't have the factor of mutual recognition that you do with ethnic categories, you know. And so I want to highlight that focusing on the numbers here looks at a particular slice, but it's not a substitute for looking at class. It's sort of, it's one way of looking at one subset of categories. You know, in that when it comes to economic liberalization, you know, you raised the question as a matter of correlation, and I realized because I presented a set of figures, it lends itself to that kind of mathematical language. I think the question of what is happening to Dalits with liberalization is, it's much better answered through contextual work. you know? And I think I'll just say maybe more speculative things, but one of the things that's happening, of course, is that with liberalization, you see these opportunities that are occurring in the private sector, and dominant caste groups are better positioned with networks, with a certain kind of financial, social, intellectual capital to make the leap from the public sector to the private sector, and also to make a leap from the private sector to a global elite. No? When it comes to Dalits and also subaltern groups, that move is harder. And so paradoxically, post-liberalization, the state ends up becoming even more important for subaltern groups. And that's also why I think you see these agitations where powerful groups are now demanding reservations, jats or patels, you know? And so I think that's an example of a question. It's more complex than a question just about identity. It's looking at an intersection of identity and class and an economic position in the new economy. And I think it's better answered by looking at these phenomena in that case than through the numbers.
Very much. I will only conclude by making two or three observations. I think this has been a fascinating paper, and I think we should take the stated objective at face value and regard that as an important issue in itself. Like, we are looking at
visible representation, or you call it descriptive representation, as an end in itself. And I think regardless of how you can break down actual representatives, there is some merit in, so even if a Dalit or an OBC leader ends up oppressing Dalits and OBCs, there is still some merit in counting, in seeing what is the actual, you know, identity of these individuals. A few observations that I'd like to make is that, following on from what Professor Bremen said, and in a way it's a point that you also conceded, it may be useful to extend the analysis to take into account these other factors that are very salient in determining electability or winnability, right? So if you were to have dummy variables for does a candidate have a criminal record, yes or no? Is he a karodpati, yes or no? Is he or she a dynast, yes or no? So you can, and then you, in a way, try to approximate the pure caste component of why a certain person gets elected. If it's possible to break that down, I think that would be, so you know, by sort of normalizing the data trying to understand better the, but in some senses, the inequalities of caste are products of political economy. But if we can narrow down in some way, that would be a useful exercise. Secondly,
that there's nothing that I've said here that says anything about the reason why you have this pattern.
Right.
So I'm certainly not making the argument that caste or class or any of these factors explains electability.
Right. Right.
And actually we do, you know, you can, and I mean there are plenty of measures for those things. All I wanted to do is to say one of the, I think what is becoming a myth about democracy in India is this very high level of inclusion.
Right.
And I wanted to question that myth without getting into the questions of what causes levels of over-representation.
Fair enough. Second point I wanted to make was that I'm wondering whether we need to, I don't know if complicate is the right word, but to leaven the notion of subalternity with the changing political economy of India. So groups that we treat as amorphous, like OBCs, for example, mask a lot of economically diverse, sectors, and where the life chances of one group that is part of OBC is very, very different from that of other groups. So maybe that's one issue that we need to, and also to see how, over the last 20 years, in a nod to the question that I think Manoj you asked, the question of how reforms and the market-driven nature of the Indian economy is also having an impact on different caste groups and sections within these groups. Third point, I'm a little less sanguine about, I think the point you make is valid, that we need to look at political parties rather than legislatures. But if you look at the fate of the inner party dynamics of some of these parties that are dominated by non-former caste, like, so Samajwadi is a great example, RJD is a very good example, even BSP, where BSP, you don't have you don't have family domination, but you have, it's highly mercurial, it's driven, it's kind of one leader who has commands unquestioning loyalty. And given the kind of structures that we see in these parties, it's hard to see how they will emerge or how they can serve as exemplars for meaningful empowerment other than in a statistical sense, which is important. And I think ultimately, if you look at the fate of the Samajwadi Party, a major part of it is not only that they lost the support of other non-Yadav OBCs, which is a widely commented upon fact, but even within Yadavs, if you make the argument that all the Samajwadi Yadav MPs in Delhi are all members of one family. So this is a kind of odd thing, which I think also we need to take on board. And if that represents, if the fate of the Samajwadi Party represents, is a reflection of the cynicism with which some of these social justice parties treat this phrase, then I think Narendra Modi, as a self-advertised OBC Prime Minister of India, takes that cynicism to the highest possible level. I think that, you know, it's a reflection of the fact that this has now become a kind of slogan which has been robbed of any real meaning. And my last point is again on this, I think to echo what Kanchan said about reforms. You know, the fact is that if you look at political economy and particularly employment, I believe the data, it's about the total number of formal sector jobs in India is more or less constant at 3.5 crore. And within this 3.5 crore formal sector jobs, these are jobs with PF, some security of tenure and so on. The shift has entirely been away from public sector and towards private sector, and you don't have reservation in private sector. And that explains a lot of the increasing insecurity that is manifested in some of these demands that we see in Gujarat or in Haryana, West UP and so on. So I think that that's an important pointer to some of these changes that are happening at the economic level and their political consequences. But I think that the data that you presented, I think the approach and the picture that you painted is depressing. But I think it's something that we all need to study and reflect on. And I thank you very much for any...
I do want to say, you know, on the question of the Samajwadi Party or the BSP, I want to be very clear that I'm not advocating for a specific party or even these parties, because what's interesting is actually in all these, the Samajwadi Party, you have a Yadav leadership, but they therefore do not promote Yadav, a second line of Yadav leadership. It's non-Yadav BCs who get privileged. Mayawati does not encourage a second line of Dalit leadership within the party. You know, so as I said, existing parties certainly have problems with you. I don't, you know, but I think the issue is if you are meant to have a meaningful level of political inclusion for subaltern groups, you would have to have political parties where the factional structure enables those groups to come up. You know, so that was
that. On that note, I'll thank you very much for your input. Thank you.